Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the National Constitution Center. I am Jeffrey Rosen, the president of this wonderful institution, which is the only institution in America chartered by Congress to disseminate information about the US Constitution on a nonpartisan basis. I am so delighted to have seen a group of you with Jacob downstairs in the Headed for the White House exhibit. Isn't it great? It's really, really interesting. Bravo to our wonderful exhibits team. It so combines constitutional content with great artifacts, and you just learn all sorts of surprising things, including, I don't know if you caught it, the fact that that Tippecanoe booze bottle, which was the log cabin booze bottle, was made by the distiller, Mr. Booze from Philadelphia, who gave that wonderful liquid its name. We have some phenomenal programs coming up. Check out the great town hall flyer, including on April 13th, Freedom Day, where we bring together some of the top thought leaders in America, including a panel sponsored by Facebook about the future of terrorist speech online, free speech on campus with the head of the ACLU and Greg Lukianoff from FIRE and David Rubenstein, and then just this wonderful constitutional feast week after week of great events coming up, culminating in our June season, which will be a Supreme Court blockbuster. You're in for a treat, ladies and gentlemen, and I am in for a treat because I've had the pleasure of welcoming to the Constitution Center for the first time a really old friend. Jacob and I go way back. We went to grad school together. We started off in journalism together at the old New Republic magazine, and I've watched with admiration his extraordinary ascent to the heights of the journalistic ladder. He now is chairman and editor-in-chief of the Slate Group, part of the Washington Post company, former editor-in-chief of Slate, and he's just rethinking digital journalism and presiding over its expansion in this remarkably changing media age. Among his many accomplishments are to host the country's leading podcast platform, which the National Constitution Center's We the People podcasts are honored to be part of, the Slate Panoply Network, and that was his brainchild, along with so many other digital innovations. Before he became czar of Slate, he was the most distinguished political journalist of my generation. I envied him when I was just starting off. He was already writing about Ronald Reagan and following him around on Air Force One, in an anecdote that you'll hear about in a moment. At places like the New Republic, Newsweek, the New York Times Magazine, Vanity Fair, the New York Times Magazine. He's written some wonderful books, including The Bush Tragedy, which is such a psychologically acute account of President Bush's 43's relationship with his father and brothers, a New York Times bestseller. He wrote In an Uncertain World with Treasury Secretary Robert Rubin. His first book was In Defense of Government. And today he's going to discuss his wonderful new biography of Ronald Reagan, which is in the American President series. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Jacob Weisberg.
Jeff, let me first just say thank you to the Constitution Center, and thank you for that incredibly kind introduction. I was going to say that Jeff and I, as he said, started as journalists together many years ago. I'm still doing that, whereas Jeff went on to a distinguished career as a constitutional scholar, lawyer, leader of large institutions, and it's particularly nice to see him here. The original founder of the Constitution Center was a mutual friend of ours, Joe Torsella, and it's turned into such an amazing place in Philadelphia and resource about American history and the Constitution. We went very quickly through the exhibition downstairs just now, and I'm going to be back very soon to go through much more slowly. Thank you for having me here.
Thank you for that. It's so great to welcome you here. You start off this great book with an account of following the president on Air Force One. You must have been, you know, barely an intern at the New Republic, and you were struck by his inaccessibility as well as his gregariousness. Tell us about what that encounter told you about Ronald Reagan.
Well, I start the book with a little bit of sort of full disclosure. I grew up in a liberal family in Chicago, and Ronald Reagan was not a popular figure in my house or at my school. Actually, I remember the when we had the mock debate at my high school in 1980, when I would have been a sophomore or junior, I played Ronald Reagan in the mock debate. The reason for that was not that I supported Ronald Reagan, there was not a single person at my high school who was actually in favor of Ronald Reagan, so someone had to be recruited as the devil's advocate to do this.
Wow.
But so my first encounters, and I did when I started as a, my sort of, not my first, but my second or third job as a political journalist, I was a summer intern at Newsweek in the Washington Bureau. And back in those days, when the media was still making money and riding high, they actually would send a journalist to do what they called body watch coverage, to be with the president all the time, every presidential trip. Time, Newsweek, even US News in those days, and lots of other news organizations would just send someone to be along, basically in case anything terrible happened. And when everybody went on vacation, I was the only one around. I said, well, I'm available. And so they sent me when I was maybe 22 or 23 years old on a couple of these trips with Ronald Reagan. And I remember it really distinctly. I mean, I remember particular things, like on Air Force One, if you were in the pool, you got to sit in the back on Air Force One. They had packages of cigarettes embossed with the presidential seal. There's a little slip cover, which I kept, because I guess it was kind of amazing even then. And you could pull out a pack of presidential cigarettes and smoke on Air Force One. The world has changed a little bit since then. But you know, I think the point is that Reagan, and that was 1987, so it was after the Iran-Contra scandal. It was when he was in some ways into his dotage. We can talk about that. But he was a kind of impenetrable figure to me. Someone with my political background could not understand seeing Reagan with these crowds in the Midwest. This was a trip to Wisconsin. We made several stops, culminating in one of these sort of Morning in America-style rallies with against the backdrop of the sunset over Lake Michigan and thousands, if not tens of thousands, of cheering people. And I remember just thinking, who are these people? Why do they love this man? I don't get it. None of my friends think any of the things they think. I didn't have any relationship to it. I didn't understand, as a journalist, Reagan's political success. And since then, Reagan's reputation has gone up and up and up to the point where conservatives certainly esteem him as the most important president of the 20th century. And I think liberals even acknowledge that he was in many ways a transformational president, even if they don't think the transformation was largely for the better. So, you know, partly writing this very short book about Ronald Reagan, and I think it's distinguished from all the other books about Ronald Reagan in that it is very short, was an exercise in kind of going back, reevaluating what I thought at the time, looking back at my prejudices, looking back at, I think, where there are a lot of liberal prejudices about Ronald Reagan, and trying to ask, who was he really? What did he accomplish? What did he not accomplish? But trying to look more neutrally and objectively at the phenomenon, which is probably, it's the rise of the conservative movement. It is, as a political phenomenon, I think the most significant to occur since the New Deal and the rise of modern liberalism.
Well, it is not only a neutral book, but it's a judicious book, and you give him his due as one of the most important presidents of the 20th century, and you set out to answer at least three big questions. First, how did he become a conservative, having started as a liberal? Second, how much credit does he deserve for the end of the Cold War? And third, who was he? How to reconcile his incredible ability to communicate with others with his personal remoteness? Let's start with the third, actually, because just to, as a way in, you went to the Reagan Library and you saw items on his desk. What did that tell you about the kind of person he was?
Well, he was, for one, he was someone who hated to throw things away, which I very much identify with. But you know, after I'd been out of the Reagan Library a couple of days looking through these presidential papers, they said, would you like to see the inside of Reagan's desk? And I didn't know what it was. And in fact, it's something that's not cataloged, but that I guess scholars who work there have generally seen. And what it is it's several file boxes that contain the things that Reagan kept in his desk, that he took from his home in Pacific Palisades to the governor's mansion in Sacramento, back to his house, to the White House, from the White House back to California after he left the presidency. And it wasn't that, I mean, he threw things away, but this was the stuff that he wanted to keep. and things he accumulated there. So I think they're quite telling objects, and some of them are very ordinary things, or you know, maybe rosebud-like things that you can't fully explain, you know, a death diary with not much of anything written in it. But there are a couple of papers that I think are really crucial. Now, I don't think these are things that necessarily give the clues to that sort of who Reagan really was question. But they do give a couple of clues to some of his ideas and some of the things that he thought were most distinctive. And maybe I'll come back to that and talk about the first question a little bit, because I think it's so interesting. And it's defeated a lot of previous Reagan biographers. You know, Edmund Morris, who wrote this famous book, Dutch, about Reagan, where he wrote it partly in the voice of an imaginary friend and wrote poems to Reagan, and I think by most accounts went a little crazy writing the book, was frustrated basically because Reagan was so impenetrable and hard to understand. He was given this access by Reagan when Reagan was in the White House and was allowed to be a fly on the wall in meetings. I think among historians, it's unprecedented access. He had more access to a sitting president than any other historian has ever had. And he got nothing, because when he would interview Reagan, when he would hear Reagan in private, he would hear exactly the same things everyone would hear in public. It's an observation that Gerald Ford actually made about him after spending time with Reagan. He said, this guy is the same in public as he is in private. And so trying to get to this sort of inner man, the real man, you can't get by asking him questions, because he just says the same things he would say on television or in a speech. And you know, Reagan didn't have close friends, really. I think probably the only people he was truly close to in his life were his mother and Nancy Reagan, recently deceased. He was not close to his children. All four of his children wrote books, all of them expressing frustration that they couldn't get to their father. They couldn't really understand him. They didn't feel close to him. Even Nancy Reagan, in her book and in a few very intimate interviews, said, you know, there's a part of him I just can't get to. There's a wall that goes up, and there's a part of Reagan you just can't reach. So that is, on the one hand, a great psychological mystery, but on the other hand, a real biographical risk, because it may be that there is no access to that. And I think what Edmund Morris took away from that is that, as he put it, Reagan had no inner life, which is a conclusion that I don't accept. I don't think there's such a thing as a person without an inner life. But I think Reagan is someone whose inner life is very, very hard to access.
You do talk about his alcoholic father and the trauma of that and the need to ignore unpleasantness and pretend that it didn't happen. You don't do a whole lot of psychobiography here, but what's your account for this apparent lack of inner life?
Well, I think that his childhood is the clue. I mean, first of all, he did have a terrible childhood. Father was an alcoholic. They were sort of driven from town to town in Western Illinois to Chicago, back. He lived in at least 10 different homes by the time he was 10 years old. So they were never in one place long enough for him to have friends, to have a stable life. Father was arrested in Chicago, had to leave Chicago. It's a really sad story. At some point, father leaves the family. He has a mistress in downstate Illinois. The family kind of covers it all up, but things are not well at home. The real giveaway is when you hear Reagan's older brother tell the story of their childhood. His older brother says, it was a miserable childhood. We barely had enough to eat. We had to go from town to town. It was rough stuff. And you hear Reagan describe it. And he says it was like something out of Tom Sawyer. And he describes walking in the woods in these Western Illinois towns and the Rock River, where he was later a lifeguard and famously saved 77 people from drowning. And he said in the winter, the Rock River would freeze over and you would skate out against the wind, and then you would come back. You would hold your coat up like a sail, and it would just propel you back on your skates down the river. And he said, you know, we were poor, but we didn't know we were poor. And he described eating these things that he recalls as sort of wonderful dishes from his childhood, oatmeal meat, which is oatmeal and meat. You know, they would beg liver from the butcher and say it was for their cat. I mean, they were on the verge of very serious poverty. And you say this man has transformed, using his imagination, something that was terrible into something that was not only survivable, but actually wonderful to him. And I think there's a really significant clue there. He had this optimistic imagination, or you could say that for someone with an optimistic character, which Reagan surely had, the use of imagination was really necessary to maintain the optimism. And a lot of what he did involved not seeing things that were painful, not hearing things that were painful. And I think those became really functional skills for him in life and in politics. So Reagan was so often criticized for telling stories that weren't true, for repeating anecdotes that had no basis in fact, for idealizing all sorts of things, for making up statistics. That's a very negative coloration on what's surely something you shouldn't make up facts in politics. But it was also a reflection of, I think, this kind of survival skill and this use of the imagination to transform the negative into the positive.
I hadn't thought of this, but I am reminded of FDR's similarly optimistic temperament, the desire to conceal unpleasantness. Jeffrey Ward, his great biographer, was here and talked about his father being sick. His instructions were always, don't upset the father, so he would constantly put on a happy face and was able, similarly remote and unknowable to his intimates, his kids didn't like him. Why don't you compare FDR and Reagan in terms of their optimism and temperament?
Oh, I think there's a real comparison there, and the first person to make it would, of course, have been Reagan himself. I mean, he grew up idealizing Reagan. A lot of people who knew Reagan in the 30s said that Roosevelt was like his real father. You know, he would famously do this when he was on his first job at a radio station in Davenport, Iowa, in Des Moines. He would do imitations of Roosevelt's fireside chats, but they weren't parodies. They were tributes. And his family was rescued by the New Deal. I mean, his brother and his father got jobs on a version of the WPA, and that kept the family afloat. And he revered Roosevelt. I think he modeled himself on Roosevelt. Reagan revived the Saturday radio address, which has since been every president has done. That was a tribute to Roosevelt's fireside chats. And I think he had a lot in common, and you were sort of pointing out in your question. Reagan is, along with Roosevelt, one of the presidents who actually had a sense of humor. I mean, Reagan said things that were funny. He said things that were spontaneously funny. He had wit, he had charm, he was kind to people, people liked being around him. I think he not only had a lot in common with Roosevelt, but probably modeled himself on Roosevelt in a lot of ways.
There are a lot of great jokes you tell here. There's the famous ones when he was shot in the operating room, make sure they're all Republicans. But he said, but then the protester comes up to him when he's governor of California and says that, you know, the future is finished, and he says, sell my bonds or something.
The Berkeley protests and which were part of what helped Reagan get elected and reelected as governor of California. He was the first politician to sort of position himself as an opponent of the student radicals. But he always liked to engage with them. I mean, he would sort of use his humor as an effective piece of his arsenal when challenging him. And he was, what I forget which University of California campus he was at, and the protest was quite vehement. And there were these hippies surrounding his car, started shoving the car, and one of them had a sign that said, "We are the future," and he held it up the window. Reagan said, "Give me a pen," and he scrawled the note and held it up. He said, "I'm selling my bonds."
So great. Well, that wit, and then the first drafts of his speeches rebuke any notion that he was some robot who was the prisoner of his staff. And you quote his speeches, and you quote his revisions of his staff's drafts, and it's clear, as you put it, that he's a great communicator who's better at actually telling a narrative and writing out the speeches than anyone else. Tell more about that as an aspect of his ability to communicate.
Well, I think one of the ways I really found to relate to Reagan is that Reagan was a writer. And that surprised me. I mean, I knew he'd kept a diary and, you know, wrote letters and so on. But no, Reagan was more than that. Reagan probably wrote every day of his life, and he enjoyed writing, and he took it very, very seriously. And in some ways, the most interesting body of writing are these radio addresses that he did between the time he was governor of California and got elected president. When he would write these scripts for these commentaries, he would do, after he ran in 1976 against Gerald Ford and narrowly lost an election and a convention, by the way, that's very relevant this year because it's the last time we really had a contested convention on either side, but on the Republican side. But Reagan was the most famous conservative in America at that point, most famous Republican. And there was a feeling after Ford lost that the Republicans had sort of picked the wrong man to run. And so Reagan was, in a lot of ways, the sort of leader of the Republican Party. And CBS, one of the offers he got was from CBS, which is the leading news national news network at that time, offering him the job of doing on-air commentaries. Who remembers Eric Severide? Yeah, it's a few of you.
Yes.
So that was, they said you could be the conservative counterpart to Eric Severide, which was probably the most prominent commentary slot you could have. And he said, no, you know, if I do on TV, people get tired of looking at me. What I want to do instead is radio. And radio, of course, was what he grew up doing before he went to the movies. His first jobs were doing sports commentary for the station in Iowa when he covered the Chicago Cubs. His favorite story about how he had to tap dance when the wire went dead, and he had to keep making up the story of more foul balls before finding out after 7 minutes that the guy at bat had fouled out on the first pitch. The way he wrote really best was for radio. And there's a great bit that George Shultz, his Secretary of State, remembers, where Shultz gave him a speech he was very proud of. And Reagan said, well, that's a good speech, but I would have done it differently. And Shultz says, well, how would you have done it differently? And he said, well, George, you write for the eye, but I write for the ear. And that was how he wrote. He wrote for people to listen to him. And these radio commentaries, which do give the lie to the idea that he was unintelligent, because they're not only intelligent, they're elegant in a certain way. They're persuasive, they're well written. They do show his limitations. Reagan was not an intellectual. His views are often simplistic, somewhat naive. He's highly anecdotal. He relates to things in terms of these stories that he either picks up or makes up that are often exaggerated or untrue. But they're really good writing, and they're really good writing for the medium. But he did the same thing with his as a correspondent, with his letters. His diaries, actually, which are probably the best known, are his least interesting writing. Because in the White House, he kept this very methodical diary where he records every time he goes to get a haircut or goes to the dentist. And it's quite literal record of what happened to him on a daily basis. And it starts, partly for that reason, starts to show, I think, very clear signs of his mental decline when his Alzheimer's started to kick in, probably in 1987, when it goes from being sort of boring to being just purely mechanical. But his real writing is, you know, expressing not necessarily personal emotion, but his views, his ideas. It's very hard to write all the time without expressing yourself in some way.
Great. Well, you set out to address this big question of his evolution from an FDR liberal into a conservative, and that is a story that has to do with his time at GE and the radio. So tell us about that evolution.
Yeah. Well, Reagan, in the early 1950s, say 1952, was still a liberal Democrat. He campaigned for Harry Truman both times. And in fact, there were two earlier attempts to get him to run for office. The Democrats wanted him to run for Congress in California. So early 50s, he's still a liberal Democrat. End of the 1950s, he is the most conservative Republican around. Becomes sort of better known when he makes his famous speech on behalf of Barry Goldwater in 1964. But he's going around the country at the end of the 1950s making these speeches that, I don't know, we would now call libertarian, where he says government can do nothing right. Essentially, there's a continuum between liberalism and Soviet communism, and we're already moving really far down that slippery slope. And if we don't do something about it, we are going to end up as a socialist or communist country. So between 1952 and, say, 1957 or 58, 59, how did this happen? It's an amazing, almost blank spot in the Reagan biography. And the reason it's a blank spot is that it's largely undocumented. Everything Reagan did before that period in Hollywood as an actor is really, really well documented. Everywhere he went, everything he wrote, everything around the blacklist and his interactions with the House Un-American Activities Committee. We can talk about all that if you want. Everything after that, when he went in politics, is of course really well documented. But in the 1950s, it's undocumented. And it was undocumented because his job was working for General Electric. After his sort of had pretty much washed up in Hollywood and couldn't get any good acting jobs anymore, he was now remarried to Nancy Reagan after having divorced Jane Wyman. He had two young children from his second marriage on top of the two he was supporting from his first marriage. He wasn't making any money. And he ended up being offered this job through Lou Wasserman, his very well-connected Hollywood agent, being the host of something called General Electric Theater and being a spokesman for General Electric. And I won't ask who remembers General Electric Theater because I'm not sure. Well, I see a few hands, yeah. that we went off the air. Well, actually, it was still on the air a little bit. It went off the air in 1957, 50. Yeah, I'm close. It was a Sunday night program on CBS that was a kind of, we'd call it an anthology program now. It was a playhouse. They would have dramas, they would have comedies. It was all sort of decent entertainment, a lot of more adapted plays. They would have, in a lot of cases, it was the first TV appearance by a major film actor, because there was a big issue in Hollywood with whether Hollywood actors were going to do TV and whether they were going to sort of tolerate this change in cultural consumption. But Reagan was the host of that program, and he would often act in that program. There's a great clip of him, the only time he ever acted opposite James Dean. It's one of the episodes from the GE Playhouse where James Dean plays this guy who's running from the law, and Reagan's a doctor, and I think Reagan ends up shooting him or something. It's a little short drama. But as part of this, Reagan also traveled the country on behalf of General Electric, speaking at all the GE facilities, all the factories where they made light bulbs and jet engines and the research labs, I think 250 facilities around the country. Every season, he would spend 6 weeks going on a train from one of these places to another, meeting thousands and thousands of people and giving these speeches, in some way representing GE. And what happened during those years is he really came to identify with and represent General Electric's political point of view, which was extremely anti-regulatory, anti-Washington, we would now say, arguing the taxes were too high. It's very identifiably, it's a corporate view, but it is very much related to the conservative, broader conservative views that Reagan showed up with on the political scene a few years later. And I don't at all think that was cynical, that he was adopting those views because he was being paid to adopt them. I think he found them highly persuasive. In a lot of ways, he was primed for them. Reagan had, for a long time, been very concerned about high marginal tax rates. So in the 1950s, marginal tax rates got as high as, I think, 91%. Now, nobody paid 91%. There were all sorts of loopholes. One of the loopholes was that if you were an actor in Hollywood, you could set up your own production company, and your income, you put everything through a production company, it would essentially be then taxed as corporate gains. So Reagan, when he was an actor, was probably paying something more like in the 20s or 30%. But when he went to work for General Electric, there were two things that were happening. One, he wasn't sure he'd be eligible for that loophole anymore because they were paying him as a spokesman, not just as an actor. And Truman had been threatening to close that and other tax loopholes. So Reagan, who had been complaining the whole time as a head of the Screen Actors Guild and as a sort of figure among Hollywood actors about high marginal tax rate, became, you know, that sort of concern intensified. But so I think a lot of things come together. He was doing a lot of reading on his own. He was reading Hayek, and he was reading Whitaker Chambers. And I think Reagan was sort of primed for a change of view. But the place where it really happens is going around and speaking for General Electric.
Fascinating. Despite that transformation and reading Hayek and becoming more libertarian, he's not a doctrinaire libertarian like Goldwater. And once he's elected governor, he shows his pragmatism. And as you tell the story, he's run on repealing the Fair Housing Act. He ends up saying that people should be free to sell their homes to whom they wish. He's anti-abortion in rhetoric, but then he signs the therapeutic abortion law that legalizes abortion. He says he's gonna cut tuition, and he more than doubles state spending on higher education. How do you reconcile this pragmatism with his libertarian evolution, and where did it come from?
I think there is this gap between Reagan's rhetoric and his ideology, both as governor of California and then as president. His rhetoric on the one hand and the way he governed on the other hand. And I think that's a credit to him. The way he governed was as a pragmatist and in many cases as a moderate. I mean, just as a thought exercise, imagine Reagan in today's Republican primary with some of his views. In favor of handgun control, the person who coined the term amnesty as a good thing we should have on immigration, because he thought illegal immigration was, I mean, he wanted to regularize the status of illegal immigrants, but he also, living in Southern California, thought that, you know, flows back and across the border were just a fact of life because the fruit wouldn't get picked otherwise. And is the man who did more than anyone else to make abortion legal in the country. Now, he later regretted that and said he was sorry about it, but he wasn't sorry enough to try to pick a first justice to the Supreme Court who would overturn Roe v. Wade. In fact, there's very clear evidence that Justice O'Connor, one of the figures around the Constitution Center here, was very clear with him about her views about Roe v. Wade and abortion and didn't give him any reason to think she would overturn the larger precedent. And he was okay with that, and he told the religious right, which challenged him over the O'Connor nomination, to back down and leave him alone. And he was, you know, he was willing to live with the status quo, even when rhetorically he was attacking it in a very vehement way.
So is it an example of his cognitive dissonance, his insistence on believing one thing when he does another, or of his admirable pragmatism?
You framing the question that way is terrific. I don't think there's ultimately an answer to that. I think to some extent Reagan didn't understand how big the gap was. In California, for example, Reagan didn't reduce the size of the government. The government, California state government, grew something like 3x during his two terms in government. Taxes went up. He was quite a good governor of California. He grew the state university system. He was very pro-environmental, protected scenic rivers. His environmental record overall was very good there. His actual record was totally at odds with what he thought it was. And when he ran for president in 1976 on the basis that he'd cut government and reduced taxes in California, it sort of looks like he thought that was true. So there is some element of cognitive dissonance. And similarly, as president, Reagan, I'm sorry to surprise anyone who didn't know this, he didn't reduce the size of the federal government. The federal government was almost exactly the size when Reagan left office as when he took office. The difference was there was a very large deficit because revenues had gone down, but expenditures hadn't gone down. I don't think that's what Reagan thought he'd done. I think Reagan thought that he had reduced the government. Now again, this is the point that by 1989, he wasn't entirely clear in his thinking about all things. On the other hand, there's a lot of evidence that Reagan was a conscious pragmatist. But I think this is a little bit where this psychological reading comes in. If you've gotten very good at not seeing things that are hard to look at and not hearing things that are hard to hear, that can be very useful in sort of squaring this circle. Of what you do, what you did isn't what you said what you're agreeing to isn't what you said you're going to do, but you want to be able to think and say that you're being coherent and consistent. And so I think that's where this sort of this sort of functional obtuseness really kicks in.
It did lead to some chaos in the White House, to scandals from the Iran-Contra scandal, to the resignation of lots of aides. Part of that reflected his extremely detached governing style, but talk about how his, and also the controversy over the budget and his encounters with David Stockman. Mm. How did his governing style and this psychological detachment contribute to the way he actually governed?
Well, let's start with the early example, his 1981 economic plan. David Stockman, who was his first budget director, came to him and said, look, I've done the math. You want this big defense increase. You want this big tax cut, but you aren't willing to cut the most expensive programs in government, i.e. Social Security and Medicare. And Reagan said, yes, nice to see you, David. And Stockman, in this book he wrote after he left, expresses his frustration with trying to get Reagan to sort of see this contradiction. And, you know, says Caspar Weinberger, who was Secretary of Defense, hoodwinked him and got him to spend more on defense than he wanted to. I think the reality is that Reagan did basically know what he was doing. He was choosing to have a deficit. He was, if you had to give up something, the thing he was willing to give up was the idea of a balanced budget. But he was never going to say that he accepted the idea of a huge structural deficit or that he didn't think it mattered to balance the budget. But that was clearly his choice. And he chose that by not doing anything about the other things. Later on, when you get into Iran-Contra, HUD scandal, some of the ethical scandals of the second term, I think Reagan no longer had a clear sense of what was going on in large parts of his administration. I mean, with the HUD scandal, which was a complicated thing, but essentially where you had a cabinet-level department that was being looted by the people who worked for it. I mean, they were writing tremendous contracts, essentially to themselves, to build public housing projects and manage public housing projects. You know, one guy would be at HUD, leave HUD, he would then be the developer who was building a big project. I mean, it was really, later investigations said essentially everything HUD touched in that period was corrupt. Reagan, you know, famously didn't recognize his own Secretary of Housing at a reception. And that was so-called Silent Sam Pierce, the only cabinet secretary who was there the whole administration, you know, watching soap operas in his office while the department was looted. With Iran-Contra, when you look back at it, I think that it's more complicated in a lot of ways, more interesting. Reagan was obsessed with these American hostages in Lebanon, and that's what started it. Reagan, because he had such a personal and anecdotal frame of mind, stories about people always resonated with him in a way that abstract ideas didn't. So an abstraction like, we don't trade arms for hostages, he could repeat that but didn't mean much to him. The idea that there were 8 Americans being held in basements in Beirut and being tortured obsessed him, really obsessed him. And he would say at national security meetings, he would start every meeting, he'd say, what's going on with my hostages? He just meant these Americans who were being held in Beirut. And he was obsessed with trying to do something to help them. And that, I think, was taken then as license by some of the less scrupulous people around him, not only to do the deal with Iran, trading arms to get them released, which Reagan clearly did know about, but then to divert the money to fund the Contras. And there never has been any evidence, persuasive evidence, that Reagan did know about the diversion. But by the time Iran-Contra came to light, when Reagan was asked about it by congressional investigators and by the special prosecutor's office in 1987, it's kind of sad to read his testimony, which has since been released, because he clearly, they're asking him, what did you know? They're asking essentially, what did you know and when did you know it? And he clearly can't answer the question, because he not only, he doesn't know what he knew. He wasn't, I don't think, in a complete fog, but on his worst days, he was in no position to answer a question like that. And of course, I think that meant at that point, you couldn't really hold him morally culpable for what he'd decided to do, because he didn't really know whether he'd decided or not. He could only find out what had been written on certain documents and what his aides were now telling him about what he had done.
So far in domestic policy, we have him laying out these big principles, but being willing pragmatically to compromise them, being disengaged enough not to be aware of the worst stuff that was committed in his name. That leads to the final big policy question you address, which is, how much credit does he get for the ending of the Cold War? Big question, you address it in all sorts of interesting ways, but give us a sense of your conclusions.
And I give him a lot, Jeff. And one way to frame it is that Reagan and Gorbachev both played tremendous roles in the end of the Cold War, but Gorbachev's role was to reform communism to make it work. Reagan's goal was to undermine communism and get rid of it. And so Reagan succeeded in his goal, even though Gorbachev was ultimately the more important figure in the collapse of the Soviet Union. It goes back a little bit to the desk, which you asked me about at the beginning. One of the things I found in those desk papers was a kind of essay Reagan had written in 1962, 1963. There was no date on it, but it was evidence that it was from. And it was one of the, it was sort of nothing else like that that he'd kept. It was a paper that was clearly important to him. And it was something called, Are Liberals Really Liberal? And in this paper, which he did not publish at the time, he was later used some of it for one of his radio commentaries in the late 70s, he says that he thinks there's a really good chance that the Soviet Union is just going to fall apart and collapse. And the reason he says this in this essay is that the system doesn't make any sense. He says it's ridiculous. It's not even an economic system. It's not even a political system. It violates human nature. It violates his understanding of how people live, which of course was both very naive and true. And it was the kind of insight that Reagan could have as a kind of outsider savant, but was ultimately right, and more right than what the leaders of either political party at the time thought, what intellectuals who studied the Soviet Union thought. But it was a very sort of plausible forecast based simply on his kind of intuition. And I think if you follow that thread, you find that in his writings all through the 60s, 70s, and into the 80s. On the one hand, he supported a massive military buildup and a nuclear buildup because he thought it was necessary to confront the Soviet Union. But people like me at that time thought that he was more willing to risk nuclear war than other people in politics, and in a way that was dangerous. Not at all. I mean, clearly, in retrospect, Reagan hated nuclear weapons. He was terrified by the idea of nuclear war, and he was increasingly desperate as president to do something to diminish the risk of nuclear weapons. But ultimately, he did not see the Cold War ending in a confrontation. He saw it ending, in many ways, the way it did end, with the collapse of the other side.
We were in grad school with Joe Torricella in 1988, and the final exam question was, when will the Cold War end? And I, spouting orthodoxy at the time, wrote a very confident essay, the Cold War will never end, it's designed never to end, it can't end, and it will continue for all times, and then the wall fell, you know, months later. Thank God, after the grade came in, I think. But, in your account, much of that was Reagan, and a big part of it was the Strategic Defense Initiative. How wacky was it? Did it ever materialize? Was it just a figment of his imagination that was a bargaining chip, or was he crazy like a fox and really onto something?
Again, you know, there's a sort of paradox there. I mean, the technology, it didn't exist. It still doesn't exist. I mean, he saw, as soon as he heard about the idea of Star Wars Strategic Defense Initiative, he started thinking of it essentially as an umbrella that you could pop up and protect the United States. And for him, this was the way out of the great conundrum of having, if there was a nuclear attack by the Soviets, the conundrum of, would you respond or not respond? He was horrified by the idea that he might have to make that choice about whether to fire a second strike. And he thought, well, when he first heard about this Star Wars thing, this is the way out. We'll just put up the umbrella. But The science wasn't there. And everyone around him, the hawks around Reagan, thought he is brilliantly building up this bargaining chip because the Soviets can't afford to do research on this technology. And it doesn't really, it's not really possible in any time frame. But there's some interesting things, and we would have the ability to pursue them, and they wouldn't. So as we're re-entering disarmament talks, we're going to get something really good for this. That's what the people around him all thought, including McFarlane, his national security advisor, who introduced him to the idea, George Shultz. The crucial moment at Reykjavik, when this should have happened, Reagan walks away from the negotiation rather than give up Star Wars, which doesn't exist and can't exist, in exchange for bigger reductions in Soviet arms than were ever thought possible before. What happened? It wasn't a bluff. He believed in it. But it ended up being an incredibly effective bluff because he so believed in it that Gorbachev, even though Gorbachev's own science advisors were saying this isn't really possible, Gorbachev thought, well, if you won't give it up in exchange for everything we're offering, there must be something there. And it's all over for us. Well, he didn't put it quite that way. But he knew they couldn't afford to build it. He knew they didn't have the technology. They didn't have the funds for the research. And I think it was one of the things that propelled capitulation and collapse.
So final verdict on how much credit he gets in light of all this. Would it have happened without him? You wonder if it had been Bush. You say maybe he would have been a realist and he wouldn't have pushed and maybe it wouldn't have happened so fast.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, in retrospect, it looks like it was in many ways inevitable. So it's a question of when it would have happened. Would it have happened as soon? And would it have happened as peacefully? And I think all you can say is, well, imagine that George H.W. Bush, who was, of course, far more sophisticated about foreign policy, in general thought of as a much better foreign policy president by people who think a lot about foreign policy. But, you know, Bush was a realist and wanted stability and was very unsettled, as were a lot of foreign policy thinkers, by the idea of the Soviet Union in crisis and the Soviet Union in some kind of uncontrolled free fall. And I think the reaction might have been very different. Instead of doing all the things Reagan did to try to propel the collapse of the Soviet Union, I think a Bush as president, or a lot of other people who might have been president as Republicans or Democrats, would have figured out how to support the stable arrangement. You know, they would have been on your side in the exam question about this is designed to exist forever. It's kept the peace. We have to make sure that it doesn't collapse, because in a state, the Cold War becomes very dangerous if it starts to unwind.
Great. Well, as usual, our questions from our spectacular members and friends are so good that let's try to get through a whole bunch of them because they're excellent. What's your favorite quote from Reagan and why?
I'm very bad at this. I do like some of the Reagan jokes, including the one. How about I come back to that one?
Okay.
Yeah.
Several questions about contrasting Reagan with the current candidates. Many current Republican candidates like to praise comparisons to Ronald Reagan. Are any of them really Reagan-esque? How would you compare Reagan to the conservatives currently running for president?
We already mentioned the sort of ideologically how different all of them are. I mean, I think Reagan, you know, sort of he couldn't run in a Republican primary now with his views on immigration in particular. Temperamentally, I certainly don't see anyone who's at all like him. I mean, if there was anyone who, you know, sort of tried to do that, maybe was a little effective, it was Rubio. You know, Rubio was kind of a sunny character, and he was upbeat, and he was trying to be Reagan-esque. It's funny, because they invoke Reagan all the time. I mean, in the first Republican debate, which was at the Reagan Library, I counted, Reagan was invoked by the candidates 74 times in the debate. They only invoke God 28 times. Which gives you a sense of the kind of hierarchy in the Republican Party. But, you know, is there anyone less like Reagan than Ted Cruz? I mean, just as a personality. I mean, no one who ever met Reagan was able to really dislike him very much at a personal level. No one who's met Ted Cruz has ever been able to like him, you know, including his college roommate. And, you know, it's sort of like, what's Lindsey Graham's, you know, joke that if he was... if he was assassinated in a full session of the Senate, 99 people would not testify, right? I think it's hard to see much of Reagan's persona in the other Republican candidates.
This leads to a related question that I'm eager for your answer to. Can you contrast Reagan and Obama, temperamentally as well as, you know, philosophically? It's a really interesting comparison.
You know, it's funny. I don't do that much political journalism anymore because I run Slate as a business, but I still dabble a little bit. But anyway, I did an interview with Obama right before he decided to run for president, and he was thinking. He was sort of grappling with the question of whether to run, and he said. He told me about being in the Washington Hilton Hotel where they have the White House Correspondents' Dinner the year before, and they have this wall in the basement where the dinner is of all sort of previous presidents, these old black and white photographs. And he said, what I remember Obama saying was, you know, if you're going to be president, you have to try to be like one of the presidents who changed things, who was consequential. And he said, like Reagan. Reagan was not his only example, but he said, you want to be that kind of president. And the decision about whether to run for president for him was, as he portrayed it then, was essentially about whether he could be that kind, whether it was possible to be that kind of president or not. So whatever I think about the comparison, I think that comparison is on his mind. And, you know, if you are trying to periodize recent modern American history, you have the New Deal, which starts in 1933, after Roosevelt's elected, continues through Truman, and then after Truman leaves the White House, you have a series of Republican presidents who, when they are in office, Eisenhower and Nixon, are in many ways still continuations of the New Deal. Government continues to expand its regulatory functions and its ambition, its size and scope. And the conservative, Reagan's conservative movement, the Goldwater movement, arises in part out of frustration that the Republicans have been so accepting of the premises of modern liberalism and of the New Deal. But you have this new period that starts in 1980 when Reagan's elected, when in fact you have less actual rollback of government than Reagan thinks or than people think, but when the conservatives become devoted to the idea of shrinking government, of pulling back from the New Deal and the great liberal project. So you have 47 years of this sort of liberal project rolling forward. Then you have from Reagan until Obama, this period of some kind of retrenchment when the movement, the overall movement, is away from government ambitions. And you could say that even in that period, even the main Democratic president, Bill Clinton, is, you know, Bill Clinton said the end of the era of big government is over. He still represented the drift started by Reagan. The question is, how does Obama figure in that? I don't think you can say anything conclusive about it. I don't think you can say either that Obama has reinstated a period of liberal activism and ambition, although he did accomplish the biggest missing piece of the New Deal, which is national health care, which is something liberals and Democrats have been trying to do since the Truman years. But on the other hand, I don't think it's right to say that he represents, in the way Clinton did, someone who's sort of still under Reagan's shadow when the primary movement was away from government. He had no support in Congress, he had no help from Congress, he was able to do much less than he wanted to do. But it's a little bit of an open question whether we're still in the Reagan era or whether the Reagan era is coming to a close, came to a close.
One more beat on it, because that's such an interesting comparison. In your account, Reagan succeeded because he was at least three things: optimistic, he believed strongly in certain ideas, and he was also a pragmatist. Does Obama have those qualities or not?
They're very different. I mean, Obama's absolutely a pragmatist, and real. But I think the difference is Obama's not an idealist in the way Reagan was. I think Obama's inclined to see things the way they are. Not the way he wants things to be. I think he is much more focused on the use of his own intellect to solve problems, which in some ways has been a weakness for him because he has believed that he's the person who can really come to grips with major foreign policy problems and work out solutions to them. He is much more modest in his ideas about about American power, what it can do, what it should be used to do. I think he's like Reagan, perhaps in the scale of his ambition, but very unlike Reagan in his management style, in his approach to policy, and probably in his temperament as well. I mean, Reagan was very gregarious, and although he didn't have a lot of close friends, liked people, liked being around people, people liked him, developed relationships with world leaders that were very important. You know, I don't think Obama has any friends among other world leaders. He's a really solitary character. He's unusual among politicians, and he doesn't seem to sort of, he doesn't love people. He doesn't derive his strength from the warmth of the crowd. And he doesn't think personal relations are what's ultimately most important in politics.
Fascinating. As you've described it, Obama's more intellectual than Reagan, and yet Reagan read Hayek. One of our guests asks, how did an actor come to read Hayek?
Well, that's the thing about Reagan. I mean, I think, and it's the admirable thing about Reagan, although he wasn't an intellectual, he was kind of an original thinker. He didn't borrow his ideas from any one place. I mean, a lot of his reading was very lowbrow. You know, he read Reader's Digest all the time. When he was in the White House, they would always try to hide Human Events, which was this lowbrow right-wing magazine that he would read and pick up these anecdotes from, and you know, off stories that often weren't true. So it wasn't like he was an intellectual and was sitting around reading Hayek, and you know, but he did read when he would follow up a trail to something or hear about something that he thought was important or interesting. He would read it and he would have his own reaction to it. When I say read Hayek, I think he read The Road to Serfdom, which was Hayek's most popular and shortest book, and was actually also published in a Reader's Digest condensed version. Who here remembers Reader's Digest condensed books? And I think that's probably the version Reagan read, actually. I do not think he read the three volumes of, what is it, The Constitution of Liberty, in which there's no Reader's Digest condensed version of that. Yeah.
Nor should there be. You said you'd return to a favorite quote at the end. I'll just show you the beautiful words from his 1989 farewell address. Well, you can read as much of them as you like.
Oh, yeah.
Give us, we need to stop now. The conversation will continue downstairs where Jacob will sign copies of this great book. But give us an excerpt from that and then sum up your judgment about how significant a 20th century president he was and why.
Excellent, thank you. Well, this is coming full circle after playing Reagan in high school debate. I can now give his farewell address. Just the interesting sort of background to this. You know, Reagan, the image of the city on the hill, which Reagan loved, this was the last and maybe the most famous time he used it. Reagan had this idea, we talk about American exceptionalism. It's not a term Reagan ever used, but it's an idea he very much embodied. And he had this vision of America as a nation chosen by God, unique in history. And when he heard in a Kennedy speech this reference to City on the Hill, which of course came from John Winthrop in his address, the pilgrims in Massachusetts when they arrived, so he then picked that up and turned his version into it. So anyway, this is a very good book, a very good bit of Reagan rhetoric from his farewell address. In the past few days, when I've been at that window upstairs, I thought a bit of that shining city upon a hill. The phrase comes from John Winthrop, who wrote it to describe the America he imagined. What he imagined was important because he was an early pilgrim, an early freedom man. He journeyed here on what today we'd call a little wooden boat, and like the other pilgrims, he was looking for a home that would be free. I've spoken of the shining city all my political life, but I don't know if I ever quite communicated what I saw when I said it. But in my mind, it was a tall, proud city built on rocks stronger than oceans, windswept, God-blessed, and teeming with people of all kinds living in harmony and peace. A city with free ports that hummed with commerce and creativity.
And if there had to be city walls, the walls had doors, and the doors were open to anyone with the will and the heart to get here. That's how I saw it and still see it. So think about that in relation to Donald Trump and walls and doors, and you have the evolution of the Republican Party over the last nearly 30 years. The last question about Reagan's, how
significant he was and why.
I think Reagan was a transformational president because he transformed the conservative, he created a conservative movement because he transformed the Republican Party and because he molded the dialogue in American politics around his views for an extended period of time. And also because of his role in the Cold War, which is a tremendous accomplishment. I don't think you can say that he was transformational in the way that FDR was, because FDR not only molded political argument around his views, but actually changed the essence of what American government was and what it did, what people expected from it, what the relationship between people and government was. Reagan didn't succeed in doing that much, but he started the country in a different direction than it's been going in, and I think it does make him a truly consequential figure.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking Jacob Weisberg.
Thank you. Thanks.
Great. Come downstairs, buy the book, and Jacob will sign it.